Welcome to the Chevy Florida Insider Fishing Report, presented by Yamaha.
Hello, all of you anglers. It's so good to see everyone back watching the Chevy Florida Insider Fishing Report. I'm Brie Gabrielle, and this is the fishing king, Captain Rick Murphy. And I hope everyone had a great weekend of fishing, but now it's time to get down to fishness. Let's all welcome back.
Fishness.
You like that? Let's welcome back Dave Farrell at the workbench, who was too busy to be here last week. Hey, Dave.
Yeah, I was being the Jonah in Miami. That's what I was doing. I couldn't get a bite.
I'm sorry.
I was the Jonah. What can I say?
Well, we're going to...
Can't catch them all the time.
Can't catch them all the time.
We had fun, though.
That's why they call it fishing.
We had a good time.
Okay, well, Rick, since you are the king of fishing, of course, why don't you tell us a little bit about the kingfish, which is our species of the week?
Well, thank you, Bree. I got to tell you, the thing that comes to mind when we look at these pictures, certainly from Saltwater Sportsman, is the big, beautiful silver fish. Now, remember this about any fish that has a V-tail, Bree, as we look at the next picture. The one thing that you need to know is they're gonna be very fast. Whether it's a wahoo, a kingfish, a sailfish, blue marlin, all of them have those little tiny tails, but don't let that mistake you. They can really get up and go. Now let's take a look at the king sailfish mount that we have here. Mm-hmm. And as you can tell, they got a lot of really razor sharp like teeth, but more importantly, the world record all tackled 93 pounds in Puerto Rico 1999. Out of 39 potential world records, Bree, 31 of them have been caught right here in Florida, which tells me this really is a kingfish mecca. Now, the biggest one in Florida that was ever taken was a very impressive 75-pound kingfish on 12-pound line in 1987. Mm-hmm. And certainly the Trossets, the Delph family, and the Harris family, they have all led the way to a lot of those world records being caught right out of Key West, which is where we catch some really monster kingfish.
Of course, only in Florida, right?
That's right.
Of course. All right, well, we're going to start the night off in the Central East region with Captain Jim Ross, whose lucky Captain Booty gets a kingfish bite all year round, don't you, Jim?
Oh, we sure do, Bree. The Central East region is real fortunate in that way. And the reason is we have a variety of reefs and wrecks that really hold a lot of king mackerel. Plus, we have sandy shoals and other contours all up and down our coast that they really like to associate during the late spring and early summer months, especially right around that Canaveral area. Now, you want to look for kingfish that are following bait pods because that's primarily where you're going to find them along those shoaly areas. Out on the reefs, though, those 70 to 100-foot reefs, that's where the most consistent bite is throughout the year. Now, our standard king mackerel tackle includes, you know, slow trolling with live baits, and the wire stinger rig is a staple here in the Central East region. Pogies, sardines, pilchards, mullet, blue runners, bluefish, ribbonfish, you know, you name it, we drag it. But those pogies and those blue runners and those ribbonfish are probably our three most popular baits that we drag around here. Our average king mackerel runs about 10 to 15 pounds, but we consistently get fish over 40 pounds. Now, the other thing that we've got in my region right now, grouper season just opened up, and last week's themed species is now this week's dinner because the gag bite has been off the chain on the 150 to 250 foot reefs and wrecks right now. You want to choose a live pinfish or a live pogie on a standard bottom rig with a VMC circle hook. That is the way to battle one of these tasty bottom fish. But Williamson vertical jigs are also working really well on the gags if you're fishing on the artificial reefs. The average fish right now is running really nice size, 15 to 20 pounds, so that's nothing to sneeze at. And the other thing that we've got going on, oh, you know what, I've got a photo here. I wanted to show that this is Shane Gordon and Alec Wong, and this is some amberjack that they caught out on those same reefs while they were trying to catch some grouper in that 250-foot mark, and those fish hit exactly what I was talking about, live pogies on a VMC circle hook.
All right, let's go inshore, bud. Yeah.
The sharks have shown up, and if you want to tussle with Jaws Jr., you don't need to look any further than the 20 to 40-foot depths this week, Reek. This is the time of year that we get lots and lots of sharks and a great variety of them. The spinners, black tips, duskies, even hammerheads are showing up right now. And you want to use live or cut bait on a wire leader. That's the best way to get them to stay hooked up. You can chum and on an anchor, or you can drift and slow troll like you're working those kingfish baits, and you can catch sharks doing the same thing. 15 to 30-pound class tackle keeps my clients fighting the fish and not the gear, and the average shark is running 10 to 20 pounds, but this week we've already had fish to over 80, and they're really common right now. Here's an example. Ted Haynes landed this 6-foot shark with me on Tuesday. This fish hit a live pogie that we were actually trolling for tarpon. It was rigged on a VMC circle hook with 80-pound Suffolk fluorocarbon leader, and this was in about 20 feet of water right off Cocoa Beach. The other thing that's really turned on right now is the speckled trout. Our mullet schools are covering most of the river flats and the lagoon flats, and the trout are right in there with them. They're getting ready to spawn, so they're really trying to feed heavily right now and build up their fat reserves and their energy reserves for that spawn. You want to start with Rapala skitterwalks or storm chug bugs around the edges of the school right first thing in the morning or last thing at night. But by around 9 a.m. or so, you want to switch to a 5-inch saltwater assassin soft plastic shad. Now, gold pepper shiner, native shiner, and golden brim color patterns have been really dynamite this week. Rig these on a weighted worm hook, and that way you can pull them through some of those grassier areas. Now, if you like live bait or dead bait, finger mullet, pinfish, and pigfish worked underneath an assassin quick cork or just set on the bottom on a VMC circle hook is working really well. Our average fish is about 12 to 15 inches, but we've had fish over 30 inches, multiple fish over 30 inches, and those are some gigantic gator speckled trout right here in the Central East region.
All right, great report. Way to start us off, Jim. I'm going to go ahead and get to the hookup hotspots from the Central East region. Captain Jim says, in short, redfish in the Mosquito Lagoon try skitterwalk plugs early and then switch to cut bait soaked in the sand holes later in the day. And then offshore, AJs and gags on the 27-fathom ridge. Use live pogies or pinfish on a standard bottom rig. You're so far away.
I know. What happened? What happened? Oh,
Rick. Oh, that's it. We got to make sure we promote the Pathfinder logo.
We also have to make sure that we tell everyone about Fish Stock in New Smyrna Beach on May 25th, which is from noon to 4 p.m. That's going to be fun. Take all the kids and the family out there. But now we are moving on up the coast to the Northeast region, where Russell Theron sure is excited that summer is creeping up on us. Right, Russ?
Oh, creeping up. It hit us wide open this week. We're out of control.
Oh, good.
All right, well, tell me what being out of control means to you, Russell Theron.
Rick, I tell you what, the weather is so nice this week. Our cobia have shown up. I saw 5 acres of Spanish mackerel. Even a friend was telling me that the boat ramp down in St. Augustine, there wasn't even a parking spot during the weekday. So that's out of control to me. But I want to talk to you guys about some kingfishing, because kingfish are one of our top targeted species during the summer months here on the first coast of Northeast Florida. One of the things that they're known for is their great speed. They're almost as fast as wahoo, and that's why they get the nickname as a smoker. Some of our best locations are Ponte Vedra, south to Matanzas Inlet, especially in that zone between 25 and 40 foot of water. Also, some local favorites enjoy trolling in front of the Red Tops, the Desert, the Captain's House, just north of the St. Augustine Inlet. Now, keep an eye open on the winds, because when the winds do blow out of the west, that'll cause an upwelling and a drop in temperature. But, you know, right now the water is very clear, and that's one of the reasons why the fishing is going off, especially down in the Matanzas and St. Augustine area. And it's moved itself, that clean water has really moved up around our area up here also. On the beach. Some of the best baits to troll are going to be live blue runners, live pogies, and of course, ribbon fish. Now, the average weight are going to go anywhere from 15 to 25 pounds. Also, Rick, today we were real excited. I've actually caught my first cobia today up here in Fernandina, so they've made it all the way up here to the St. Mary's. And spring is the best time of year, just right now, to sight fish the cobia here in our region. The best time of day is basically you want to be on the water between 10 and 2, and especially when the sun gets up, so it's bright enough that you're ever going to see, you know, through the water, you know, when it's really calm and clear. Now, I'm noticing that a lot of the guys that are catching the cobia in the southern part of my region are catching them more on the rays and on the bait pods. The day I found the cobias laying up on the sea buoys. But also in the same zones that these tides, you want also, we got some really defined tide lines because of all the rain that we had earlier in the last couple of weeks. And also, too, check behind some of the shrimp boats. You can free line a pokey behind the shrimp boat and pick up a cobia that way. But I love using light tackle, jigs, and flies. Some of the best baits are an eel or a blue crab, a pokey, or a mullet. Some of the typical cobia are running anywhere from 20 to 35 pounds.
Let's go inshore, buddy.
Yes, sir. I talked with Captain Dennis Goldstein with Hot Fun Fishing Charters out of Comanche Cove, Yacht Basin, Yacht Harbor in St. Augustine. Now, he said the water is the best that he's seen in a long, long time. Now, he's doing the best catching Spanish mackerel and some big bluefish on the south side of the mouth of the St. Augustine Inlet on the flood tide. Now, we talked about May being one of the best months to catch the really big bluefish that run anywhere from 10 to 14 pounds. Now, you'll find them finning along the South Rock Jetty there in St. Augustine Inlet on the last or the beginning of the ebb tide, the last of the flood or the beginning during that high tide. Those big bluefish will lay up in there as those mullet come down those rocks. That's what they're wanting to get. Several methods to catch the Spanish mackerel. Are using trolling lures are very popular for catching for years. But I like to use spin tackle rig with a good Suffolk braid line. Or I'm able to make long casts, you know, to be able to cover more area. And make using a spinning reel to make a very fast, you know, retrieve. I like casting a half-ounce Castmaster spoon with a small wire leader. Is really all you need. Now, the fly fishermen also can get into the action with either a 6, 7, or 8 weight fly rod, rigged with an intermediate line, which is a clear line that's going to get down, and with a shortened wire leader or a monofilament leader tied, you know, on for the fly. And we had a dozen Spanish that we took today on fly up here in front of off of Amelia Island. Typical size Spanish mackerel gonna run anywhere from 1 to 3, and a big one up here will run 5 pounds. And I'm really happy that we had. I saw more today than I've seen in a long time.
Quickly, now, tell me about the whiting. Tell me about the whiting, quickly. Come on.
The whiting. If the guys want to lay back on the beach and enjoy some good fishing with the family from Ponce Inlet to St. Mary's Inlet, you want to fish the surf either you know by in the surf or in a boat. Use a double hookup rig. With a 1 or 2 ounce VMC circle hit, tip with a small peeled shrimp, and soak it in Diet Cola. That's what the locals do. They can run anywhere from a half to a pound and a half.
All right, Russell, we got to go. I'm going to go ahead. I'll take care of the CCA for you, and then I'll read your hot spots. So let's go ahead and take a look at the CCA Florida Jacksonville chapter. They're going to have this barbecue on the May 15th at 6 p.m. at the Aldorf Brewery on Hickory Avenue in San Marco. So, guys, make sure you check out the CCA chapter barbecue. And then also, let's take a look at the Northeast hotspots from the Jacksonville, Ponte Vedra area. So, inshore, we're going to talk about target redfish as well as sea trout during the sunrise and sunsets this weekend on the outgoing tide on topwater plugs. And then offshore, sight fish cobias on the bait pods and sea buoys, tide lines, and behind shrimp boats. The best baits are live mullet or even a live pogey.
I love how he's so enthusiastic all the time.
Yeah.
Yeah.
A little too much tonight.
No, not too much. Okay, coming up on the Chevy Florida Insider Fishing Report, we're going off the deep end with Dave, and then we're going to talk to a special guest who is the king of kingfish, and then we'll check in with the Central West region, so stay tuned.
The Chevy Florida Insider Fishing Report is brought to you by Chevy. Find new roads. Best parts, best prices. Bennett Auto Supply. Yeti Coolers. Wildly stronger. Keep ice longer. CCA Florida. The voice of recreational anglers for over 25 years. Contender Boats. Performance through innovation. Humminbird. Simply, clearly, better. And King Sailfish Mounts. www.kingsailfish.com.
It's such a good vibration. It's such a sweet
adore.
The Chevrolet Cruze, loved in 119 countries around the world. Proof we're not so different after all. It's the new world.
Yamaha's next generation V6 four-strokes are changing the game.
Mid-range power was awesome.
Fuel the burn. It's unbelievable.
Couldn't believe the speed and the fuel economy is pretty impressive.
Yeah, I couldn't believe the power. It was like a I was more like doing a quarter mile on a drag strip.
And them things are like, it's a whole other game.
So I made the switch.
Experience the difference for yourself during the Yamaha Discover V6 Offshore Demo Tour. See why we call it the game changer.
It's been said that a bad day of fishing is better than a good day at the office. But down here in the Florida Keys, we have to disagree. Because with over 200 of the world's best charter boat captains and guides, there's no such thing as a bad day of fishing. The Florida Keys and Key West.
Continuing the revolution. Faster, drier, even better built. Designed around Yamaha's latest technology outboards. Still built by the same craftsmen and anglers who launched the Bayboat Revolution. Whether chasing world records, or time on the water with the family, or anything in between, there's a new Pathfinder model for you. Pathfinder, number one for a reason, still.
Now it's time to go over the news and notes from the FWC. May 16th through the 18th is Ladies Let's Go Fishing in Treasure Coast. May 31st, there's the Kids Fishing Clinic in Fernandina. And June 7th is the Women's Fishing Clinic in St. Pete. For more information and events, you can go to myfwc.com. But now it's time to go off the deep end.
Well, welcome to the Jägermeister off the deep end.
Jägermeister. He gets to wear it on his shirt.
But you know what? We got Brian Humphreys from the Jägermeister Offshore Fishing Team. Brian, welcome to the Chevy Florida Insider Fish Report. Dave, let's talk about rigs and techniques for kingfish.
We bring in experts sometimes, you know, instead of having to listen to what I have to say. It's always a good thing. Now, when I used to do a lot of kingfishing up in the Cape Canaveral area, you're from Fort Pierce, but you travel around. And the hardest part was always trying to find the spot where they are. What are the process that you go to try to find the body of fish that you want to go after?
Well, typically for traveling, say to Key West from Fort Pierce or north, we typically would try to leave a little bit earlier, a few days before the tournament and pre-fish, take a few days off of work, get settled in, maybe find where that bait is, and then look for where the fish might be. If time doesn't permit, can't get the time off of work, some less expensive, less costly ways would be to look on charter boats websites, look at the drift boats, see what they're catching, see what they're bringing in. So when you get in, you can kind of get dialed in and see at least maybe where the fish might be.
Are you allowed to get intel from other guys like in the area?
Absolutely. A lot of the guys that I fish against, we're pretty close-knit group of guys. We share the information. We don't tell each other everything, but we definitely talk to each other.
So let's say you find that spot, and what's the first bait that you want to put out? If you had all the baits you could go through, what are your favorite ones and what order?
Well, typically I'd like to fish with whatever I know that those fish are hitting in that area. So if I'm fishing Key West, it's a large, very large blue runner. But if I'm just going down, I don't have a lot of intel. I'm looking for goggle eye. I'm looking for blue runner. I always have ribbon fish on my boat. A little costly to fish with those at times because the trigger fish like to get a hold of them as well, but ribbon fish is always a good alternative. Out of Palm Beach lately, the fish have really been hitting sardines. Kind of shying away from the goggle eye and the blue runner.
Is it a bigger the bait, bigger the kingfish type thing, or no?
You know, you'd like to think that sometimes, but I'll tell you what, the sardines have been pulling 60-pound fish in out of Palm Beach and Boynton in the last 2 weeks, so we've kind of been shying away from those big baits.
Are you fishing the sardines under kites, or are you bumping them in and out of gear? What's your presentation when you're putting these live baits out?
My presentation is typically as natural as possible. I want that fish to look as free as can be. Don't want the kingfish to see the hooks, the wire. I want the bait to be look as free as possible. So the rig needs to really be unobtrusive, in my opinion.
So how far down will you go? I mean, I normally fish with like 6-7 wire, just fun fishing. But when you guys are tournament fishing, trying to get that bite, what are you doing?
We'll go anywhere between a number 4 wire. Sometimes we'll use titanium. Titanium is very expensive, but it's more forgiving in the fish's mouth, in the kingfish's mouth. You talked about the teeth earlier. Typically, when you have a wire, if that wire kinks, it's going to break. Titanium has a little more
Brian, I got a question for you. Now, you hook this big kingfish. They're going to run off big. That's why they got the nickname the smoker. Do you guys typically fish a real, real light drag, just trying to stay connected, or do you put some pressure on them?
Absolutely. We everything I use is very light. Light drag, I use small hooks, small wire, because I don't put a lot of heat on the fish. We actually use the boat a lot to get real quick back on the fish in order to not put a lot of pressure on them. We use high-speed reels. You know, you're getting 6 foot back every time you crank the reel. And we're really using that boat to get back on them. So we're not using a whole lot of heavy drag. We're using real light drag and really using the boat to kind of follow that fish
now
until he gets tired.
Is that because the kingfish's mouth and the way he's got all that hard stuff to hook, or they get foul hooked a lot? Or is that why you prefer to use the lighter drag?
You know, they hit the bait so fierce sometimes there's a lot of foul hooks, especially with the ribbon fish. You'll find that you're fighting the fish from the side of his body. That becomes a problem. Their flesh is extremely soft, so the hooks tend to pull very easily. And you're oftentimes fighting the sharks, is really what it comes down to. So you want to get that boat right back on top of that fish as quick as possible so you can get them in the boat and you know.
Man, that's some really good, insightful stuff. A little different twist over here at the Jägermeister.
Well, somebody who knows what they're talking about. It's always a really good thing.
Oh, man.
All right, well, Bree, we got to switch gears. We're going to go from the bench to the dock. So what are we going to next?
That was a nice little twist. Thank you, Brian, for being here. But right now we're going to say hi to Captain Jeff Page in the Central West region with all the kingfish scoop. Hey, Jeff.
Hey, Bree. Hey, I just learned something. I heard Captain Rick say that they got their nickname the smoker because they smoke line off the drag. I thought they called them smokers because that was about the only way that they were worth eating. You had to smoke them.
Probably a little bit of that too there, Jeffrey.
Okay. Well, in our Starbright Central West, kingfish are really popular. And usually about by this time, Rick, the season of the migrating fish is winding down. But we had such a late run of cold fronts that there's still lots of migrating fish stationary in our area and still showing up from the south. The key is finding the big schools of threadfins. I heard your guest talking about keying in on the bait, wherever the bait is, and that's been the key this season. The threadfins have been way offshore, but now they're pushed in closer to the beach. You find those big groups of threadies, you're going to find the kings, and then once you do, there's a couple different ways you can catch them. You control, you know, lipped plugs like the X-Wrap 20s or 30s. The guys around here like using that silver-blue pattern, as well as any kingfish spoon, and the wire or the titanium is a really good thing to throw in there unless you've got a box full of lures. As far as live baits, live blue runner is probably the bait of choice, but once again, with all the threadies around, it doesn't hurt to get you a sabiki up a couple dozen thread fins and flatline those or troll those with a stinger rig. The king in our region, average size 15 to 25, and then we get our bigger smokers, usually in the fall, and those can be 25 to 40-pounders with an occasional 50-pounder mixed in. I've got a nice photo tonight of Captain T.J. Stewart and one of his clients with about a 35, 40-pounder that he caught at the Skyway Bridge.
That's a great picture, T.J. Hey, Jeffrey, before we go on offshore, I want to talk about the Navionics from the south part of your region. Now, we're talking to guys about Stump Pass area. Now, the one thing that Captain Jeffrey was telling me is that the kingfish and the tarpon in the last few days have really showed up. So the one thing that I really see here looking at the Navionics is this drop-off according to the sonar soundings. And what I'm seeing here is this real distinct line where we go from 8 feet to 22 feet is certainly going to be where the tarpon are going to be swimming. But we're talking about kingfish this week and all these humps and bumps out here. Look at this, where it goes from 20 feet down to 30 feet just in a real short period of time. These are the places where the bait's going to stack up. And guess what? You're going to find those big kingfish there as well. All right, Jeffrey, what else you got for me offshore?
Species 2 offshore. Still lots of cobia coming in from our offshore, near shore, and our wrecks and reefs out at the M7 and M11s, which are, you know, anywhere from 9 to 15 miles out. Live pinfish on a standard bottom rig has been getting the job done, but it's a good idea to have a flat line ready to throw at them in case one swims up to the boat, follows up one of your groupers, what have you. There's been some taken at the Skyway as well, just like the kingfish, and I have another photo from Captain T.J. Stewart of an 80 20-pound Kobe he got last week at the Skyway.
Dang. Wow. Man's on fire.
That's big for our region, Rick. That's real big for our region.
Good job, TJ. Keep up the good work. All right, let's
go
inshore.
Inshore. Spanish mackerel, lots of Spanish mackerel are showing up not only along the beaches and offshore, but also in our bays and up around the Skyway Bridge. You know, I mentioned the Skyway so much this week because that's where all the bait has been holding, and all the fish are around it, as well as the grass flats off Rattlesnake Key and Emerson Point, which are just south of the Skyway. And then when you come back down towards Sarasota Bay, the middle grounds in Sarasota Bay, because there's been a push of small bait that has moved in there. Use free line pilchards or smaller thread fins or the Mirror Lure MR17 Merodine in the chartreuse silver pattern. And don't be surprised if you catch a nice speckled trout or bluefish mixed in. Species 2, redfish. Redfish bite remains strong with good upper slot fish being caught throughout our entire region. To the north, the fish are on both sides of Long Bar as well as the Terracea and Palmasola Bay area. Guys are using the Saltwater Assassin Golden Brim Sea Shad on a quarter-ounce chartreuse hookup jig head or cut chunks of ladyfish when the tide gets higher, and they're pitching them up right up along the oyster bars or the mangrove bushes. To the south, the east and west side of Lemon Bay looks good for reds. They're mixed in with the mullet schools, and you can throw that new Rapala Balsa X minnow in the olive green pattern. I've got a photo today, tonight of a redfish that Dr. Russell Novak caught with me Sunday. One other note to add.
Yeah, go ahead.
In the central west region, don't forget to visit your Tires Plus car care centers. And when you get in there, make sure you ask them for the Captain Rick Murphy discount special. And like always, get you a Chevy truck.
Good job, Jeffrey. I'm going to go ahead and get to the Central West Tires Plus hotspots. Inshore, nighttime snook fish the dock lights and bridges between Blackburn Point Bridge and the Venice Jetty. Live free line shrimp or DOA glow shrimp are the best bet. And then offshore, kingfish holding in and around the bait schools in 20 to 35 foot depths troll blue runners and thread fins, just like we showed you on the Navionics there.
The special Rick Murphy discount.
That's it.
What?
Man, we just created it.
All right. Well, speaking of Mr. Page, Rick and Jeffrey will be at the Carl Black Chevrolet in Orlando on May 29th from 6 to 8 p.m. So make sure you check them out, the special Rick Murphy discount. But don't go away, because next on our list is the Panhandle and the Keys region right here on the Chevy Florida Insider Fishing Report.
The Chevy Florida Insider Fishing Report is brought to you by Yamaha. Reliability starts here. Bass Assassin and Saltwater Assassin, the best lures, period. Blue Water Outriggers, everything for your outdoor adventures. Guy Harvey Clothing by AFTCO. Crokey's, made in the USA. Drummond Community Bank. Costa, see what's out there. And Casa Vieja Lodge, five-star angling in beautiful Guatemala.
What is CCA? CCA has been representing recreational fishermen for over 25 years, and when your rights to fish are threatened, the CCA is there to make sure government regulators are making sound decisions. I'm a life member of CCA, and when fishery decisions are being made, the CCA in the room is fighting for our recreational rights. We need to give our kids the same opportunities to fish as we did. Do what I did. Go to ccaflorida.org and join for only $25 so you can protect your recreational angling rights.
Hi, I'm Harold Bennett. My dad started Bennett Auto Supply over 57 years ago. Things have changed since then. We've grown to 33 stores and opened a 93,000 square foot distribution center. But one thing has stayed the same, our focus on the customer. That's why we have the most knowledgeable parts specialists in the business, and we only offer quality auto parts at the guaranteed lowest prices. The next time you need anything for your vehicle, think Bennett Auto Supply. Best parts, best prices, Bennett Auto Supply.
A man and his truck, and tofu.
Express yourself.
And veggie burgers and raw kale salads, all fine, just not today.
Whatever you do.
Introducing High Country, the premium Silverado.
Do it good.
Silverado 2014 North American Truck of the Year.
Fish Dock, the total saltwater experience, returns to New Smyrna Beach this Memorial Day weekend. Bring the whole gang to Riverside Park for an incredible family experience. Tournaments, boat shows, seminars, kids clinics, chowder cook-off, and the Fish Dock 5K Fun Run. Visit fishdock.com to register for the new Bill Fish Open, the Offshore Striker Tournament, or the Redfish Trout Challenge for your chance to win thousands in cash, prizes, and much more. Fish Dock, Memorial Day weekend in New Smyrna Beach. Don't miss this one.
For weekly reports from our 9 regional captains and our latest events, make sure to check out our website at the Chevy Florida Insider Fishing Report.com. You can also like us on Facebook and even send us your fishtastic photos, plus follow us on Instagram at Captain Rick Murphy and Official Insider. But you know what, Rick? I think it's about that time to announce our next contest.
Tell me.
I will. Sponsored by Bennett Auto Supply, Bennett's Catch a Big One contest will give 4 lucky winners a chance to go on a fishing charter with captains from our show and take home a prize pack. You want to tell them what's going to be in that prize pack?
Well, certainly the captains are Mike Holiday, Jimbo Thomas, Jim Ross, and then Ronnie Houston. More importantly, we got swag for days. We got Tervis tumblers. We got Chevy Florida Insider Fishing Report shirts for the girls and the guys, and performance wear by Guy Harvey. So I gotta tell you, I'm excited about the swag and people going fishing with our guys.
The swag, you totally stole my swagness. I said that first. All right, now we're heading way on up to talk with Captain Patchneen. Stop, turn around. In the Panhandle region where the bait sure are holding those kings. Do what you do, Pat, before he turns around again.
The Gulf baits are here, the cigar mill earrings, redfins, blue runners. And when they show up this time of year, the kings are right behind them. In fact, the kingfish bite's been good to very good the past 2 weeks throughout the Panhandle. Just before last week's rain event, the kings were thick off depth, and Captain Brandon Wright, he had some really good trips using topwater baits, the top dog mirror lures, and the kings were skyrocketing on those baits. Typically, we find the kings around the bait schools and over bottom structures starting in May, lasting through October. And I spoke with Captain Jason Hallmark on the bench, and he tells me this week the kings are around that type of structure, the fads and the wrecks and the reefs in 80 to 100 foot of water. You want to slow troll a live cigar minnow or herring on a stinger rig. Put a couple baits flat up on the surface right off the rod tips, and then a couple baits deep either behind a downrigger or a trolling lead. So right now the fish are running 10 to 20 pounds, plenty of those fish being caught, but there are some being caught, you know, 30 to 40 plus pounds. And there's a photo of a 46-pound king caught this past week over in Pensacola on Captain Chaz Heller's boat with Heller High Waters charters in Pensacola. So, man, that's a really pretty king mackerel right there.
You're not kidding, Pat. All right, tell me about some pretty fish like a yellowfin tuna.
Man, that's some good eating right there, Rick. It's a long way to go, but the rigs are producing some good tuna bites on live baits and chunk baits. There's a good push of blue water in the northern Gulf. And the offshore floaters are where you want to be, particularly the Nakika rig and south towards the Blind Faith and Thunder, the Blind Faith area. Bump troll live hardtails are small black fins on 80 to 100 pound leaders, usually on the upcurrent side of the platform, or linger in the area where you see the tunas jumping or where you're marking them on the fathometer, and they'll eventually come up. If the troll is not working, set up a drift and try chunking with blackfin, bonita, Boston mackerel, or whatever you may have. Make sure your hook baits sing naturally just like your chunk bait by pulling the line off your rod tip, not off the reel. And the tunas are running 40 to 80 pounds. And where you find those tunas, you're going to find some blue marlins. In fact, Captain Miles Coley on the Real Worthless had a great overnight trip, and they went 3 for 5 on blue marlins out by those rigs. So the offshore bite is definitely heating up. And moving inshore, the bays throughout the Panhandle are very stained from this past week's rain. But the redfish has still been pretty good despite the water color or water clarity. The docks and grass flats near the points around Choctahatchee Bay are holding redfish in 20 to 25-inch range. The docks west of Navarre in the Santa Rosa Sound are producing plenty of fish, with a lot of them in that 25 to 28-inch range. With the stained water, spoons or soft plastics with a spinner bait, that flash is working real well in the dirty water, or a clacker bobber with a live bait. And where you find one fish, you should find several more. So drop your power pole or drop your anchor and fish that area thoroughly before you move on. And then finally, the beach fishing has been very good for pompanos and a variety of other species. But this year, the springtime, the pompano bite's been excellent throughout the whole Panhandle. Captain Terry McGowan over in Panama City reports that the beaches of Shell Island are the place to be. here in Destin, Holiday Isle, and also the Stan Destin area. I've been producing some good catches. And over in Pensacola, look for that water east of Fort Pickens to, you know, just move just far enough east to get out of the bay water, the stained, you know, bay water. Set fishermen are baiting with sand fleas. They're catching pompanos, bull redfish, and a few sheephead. But don't be surprised if a cobia or some jackerel show up as well. And there's a photo of my buddy Mark next week, Roundtree. And a 74-pound cobia he caught this last Saturday on his paddleboard right there off Henderson Beach. He was out there pompano fishing, and that big cobia swam by, and he got him.
It looks like my boy Mark there is doing that paddling, and not the only thing getting to work out. All right, man, good job, Pat. Way to get us started tonight, and I appreciate the Panhandle Report. We're going to take a look at the Blue Water Outriggers hotspots from the Panhandle region. Inshore, black-tip sharks on the beaches of Shell Island using cut ladyfish, and then offshore, natural bottom in 180 to 230 feet of water for vermilion snappers using cut bait on a chicken rig. Anything to do with a chicken, Brie, it's got to work.
It's got to work. Man, that guy looked like he could catch a lot of fish.
Yeah, he caught your eye.
Yeah. Well, wouldn't it be nice to be a king in paradise? And Captain Randy Tao from the Keys region is going to tell us just how nice it is. We missed you, Randy.
Hey, good evening, fish fans. I'll tell you what, I missed everybody. Oh. The Bahamas, it's nice to visit, but it's also nice to get back home. And that's what I did, and we're fishing every day. It's pretty good. You know, the kingfishing is a species of fish that we catch throughout the Keys. You catch them on the Atlantic side, you catch them on the Gulf side. You fish a little differently placed. For example, up in Amarada, you might fish for kingfish on the edge of the reef or around a wreck with live bait. That's kind of the go-to for us. A pilchard, a speedo, a cigar minnow, that's a great live bait on a short piece of number four wire. And the winter and the spring months are really better for us here. Now, that changes a little bit down toward Key West. They've got a lot of kingfish, both the Atlantic and the Gulf. And you're fishing a similar type of bait, but they like blue runners down that way. Out in the Gulf of Mexico, for example, if you're going to fish some of the wrecks out there, you can anchor on some of these wrecks and chum with live pilchards and get these kingfish up on the surface if you want to throw a fly rod or catch them on light tackle, because it's shallow water. There's not a lot they can cut you off on. So a kingfish really is a popular fish throughout the Keys, and there's many ways to go about these fish to catch them. Our dolphin fishing right now, it's that time of year where a lot of people, that's what they want to do, go offshore, get into the dolphin. Here we are, early May. And, you know, the dolphin fishing's kind of tough right now. It's up and down. There might be 30 guys out there fishing on any given day, and maybe one or two will come across a big fish. Now, 400 to 600 feet of water's kind of been the zone. A lot of weeds out there. We've been dealing with a lot of wind, and then it changes directions. So the winds, the weeds are kind of scattered. So you're going to find scattered weeds. You really want to look for the birds. Birds are key when you're dolphin fishing, especially if you find the man-of-war birds. Those are usually the birds that are going to have the bigger fish on them that you can target with a pitch bait. That's a spinning rod that you have rigged up with a flying fish or a ballyhoo to cast at the fish when you see them. And a lot of times when you get out there, you put your troll baits out, and you just wait, look in your binoculars, and you wait to see that magic bird or a floating piece of debris, and that's your ticket for a lot better dolphin fishing. The backcountry fishing, you know, when everybody's tarpon fishing, it opens up good snook fishing and good red fishing. And the red fishing right now, if you've got a technical boat that goes shallow, you're probably going to have some pretty good fishing because there are not a lot of guys red fishing. Everybody wants to go tarpon fishing. So some of the guys I've been talking to that are taking a break from tarpon are some real good luck up on top of the flats around Flamingo. You got to have enough water to get up there. That's kind of the key. And they said most of it doesn't really matter if it's an incoming tide or an outgoing tide, as long as you have water. Now, if you've got a bigger boat, like a bay boat, you're going to need a little more water to fish the shorelines or some of the channels where the water's falling off into the deeper water, and you're going to get those redfish coming off the flat. The tarpon right now, it's tarpon season. Just like it's dolphin offshore, it's tarpon inshore. And a lot of these tarpon right now, because of the weather we've been having, they're concentrated around the bridges a lot more than they are in the backcountry right now. Live crabs are still a great bait. A live mullet, if you can get it. If you can't get it, put one at the bottom with a 3 or 4 ounce egg sinker and just wait. A lot of these fish are swimming on the bottom. They're scavengers. They're going to find that mullet sometimes a lot easier than they will a fish, a bait on the surface. And if you're a fly fisherman, plenty of fish moving on the ocean side, even with these high winds. And the fly fishing guy having a ball throwing at the tarpon, unfortunately, they're not biting too well.
Randy, I got a question for you. You know, this time of year, you got it going on inshore and offshore. Guy calls you for a charter and he wants to go next week. If you had the time available, what would you recommend to him?
You know, it depends if he's got how many people in his party, if he wants eating fish or he wants a game fish. And that's the beauty of it right now. Some people want to go after that game fish. They want one fish. And some people want, you know, a cooler full of fish to take back and give to their friends and family. So you've got dolphin offshore and you've got tarpon inshore.
That's exactly the beauty of the Florida Keys. And I'm going to go ahead and get to the La Jolla hotspots from the Florida Keys. Good job, Randy. Inshore, tarpon, still plenty of fish around the bridges. And for the fly fishermen, a very good migration of fish swimming to the south. And then offshore, dolphin, looking 400 to 600 feet for the weeds and debris, and also look for the man-o-war birds working to the southwest, Brie.
Well, you know, it always happens after Mr. Randy Town the Keys. We gotta tell him about the tournaments in the Keys.
Tell me about it.
All right, let's do that right now. So for the tournaments in the Florida Keys, the Florida Keys Dolphin Championship, set for May 16th through the 18th, is a Keys-wide tournament with five different weighing stations from Key Largo to Key West, with more than $100,000 in cash and prizes. Special flies, accurate casts, and luck are the recipe for winning the Golden Fly Invitational Tarpon Tournament, May 18th to the 21st in Isla Mirada. Anglers must use tournament-furnished tippets not greater than 16-pound test. At the Yamaha Dolphin Masters, set for May 23rd and 24th in Key West, more than $13,000 awaits the angler scoring the highest total combined weight of three dolphin catches. And the third annual Ladies Dolphin Tournament, scheduled for May 31st in Key West, features more than $10,000 in cash and prizes. And of course, now we have Andy Newman on the line to tell you about even more of those wonderful tournaments. Hey, Andy.
Brie, and that Florida Keys Dolphin Championship, it
yes.
has a Sea Hunter Bay Boat as the grand prize. And guess what? You can actually fish a second dolphin tournament at the same time. The Big Pine and Lower Keys Dolphin Tournament, also being staged next weekend, May 16th to the 18th, and there's an entry discount for anglers who register for both contests. Now, in that Big Pine tournament, the angler who catches the largest dolphin weighing more than 50 pounds will earn $20,000, and there's additional cash and prizes, making the total tournament purse more than $35,000. More information at lowerkeyschamber.com, and, of course, more details on all the tournaments in the Florida Keys at flakeys.com. Now, Rick, you remember that last year, you were the 20th anniversary celebrity host at that Big Pine Dolphin Tournament.
I sure was, Andy, and I got to tell you, the people in the Keys just welcomed Kathy and I down there with open arms. We stayed in the beautiful Key West Resort down there, and Big Pine, the guys put us on so many fish. We had the best time, and that's what the people in the Keys are all about, having a big time.
You have such a hard life, Rick.
I do.
Oh my
Standing
goodness.
Next to you, it's full time.
Oh,
you know?
Gosh, I know. Okay, all of you kings and queens, don't you dare leave that throne, because when we come back, we'll be checking in with Dave for some of that fishing swag, which is my word. Thank you very much. And we'll be seeing what's biting in the Southwest region. We'll be right back.
Just like a woman trying to claim everything.
For sure.
The Chevy Florida Insider Fishing Report is brought to you by the Florida Keys and Key West. Come as you are. Hookup Lures, premium lures for serious anglers. FWC, the Florida Fish and Wildlife Conservation Commission. Guy Harvey, artist, explorer, marine scientist, conservationist, diver, and fisherman. La Jolla Resort, a place for family and fishermen. Maverick Boat Company, makers of premium boat brands, Maverick, Hughes, and Pathfinder. Navionics, we start where the road ends.
It's 200 streamlined horsepower of Yamaha forward thinking. The all-new F200 inline four-stroke. Whether you're an offshore angler, pontoon cruiser, bay boater, or walleye hunter, the responsive and fuel-efficient F200 combines amazing power and versatility in one incredibly compact and lightweight package. The all-new F200. Legendary Yamaha reliability and the freedom of forward thinking.
You know there's more to it than luck. There's fishing the right bait, the water temperature, the wind, the season, and then there's the boat. We'll put it simply, the boat matters. To own a Contender is to own the best sport fishing boat on the market, period. Contender offers the most comprehensive model range with bigger, faster, and more fuel-efficient boats than the competition. There's only one choice for serious anglers. Contender Boats. Performance through innovation.
Suffolk's 832 is constructed with seven strands of Dyneema and a single strand of Gore Performance Fiber. It's the roundest, longest casting line in the world. It offers superior abrasion resistance so you can fish it anywhere. It's the strongest, most sensitive, and durable small diameter braid ever to hit the water. Nice fish, Brett.
Thanks.
Suffolk's 832. Always use the best line.
Welcome back to the Chevy Florida Insider Fishing Report and the Jägermeister Workbench. We're here to talk about new products, and unfortunately, Dave is playing in the toy box.
I'm not going to spray you with this. Might get in your eyes or something.
Something.
Yeah. Anyway, this is a new product from Starbright, and this is a product that's a long time coming, and in my opinion, with all the new nice screens and stuff we have on boats, a lot of electronic stuff that we have, this is a screen cleaner and protectant from Starbright, so that you can spray on your touch screens and get all the fingerprints and the smudges, because we're always touching those touch screens now, and we're always getting them all messed up, and we're always worried about what can I put on them without ruining them. Starbright saves the day. Screen protectant, cleaner and protectant with the PTF.
I'm going to try it on my Costa.
It's good for sunglasses.
You know how
it's good
bad
for your
it is
phone.
When you get the chicken grease from Dion's in your glasses.
Yeah, I did that on the way here today. I always get chicken flakes in my Costas.
What else you got?
Well, we got from Salt Armor. They're making these new protective rod butt gimbal covers. You know, a lot of the rods that we use have a metal gimbal on the end, and if you have a really nice cockpit or a fiberglass finish and you start banging on them with the metal gimbal, you're going to mess them up. So if you don't have a plastic gimbal that comes with your rod set, you can get these from Salt Armor, and they have them from 30 to 50, 50 to 80, 80 to 130. If you've got a rod with a gimbal on it, they make a protector for
it's nice to keep them chipping.
And they got black ones and clear ones if you're into that sort of thing,
yeah.
You know, if you want to be really. Now, this is a really cool knife from SOG. SOG, they make a lot of knives. A lot of outdoor equipment, but this knife, you know, a lot of fellas go fishing at night. This has a light inside of it, so you push on the end of it, on the end, and it's got an LED in both sides of the knife, so you don't have a shadow on either side. If you go snook fishing, you come back, you want to clean your snook out on the back dock, you don't have a really powerful light, or if you're on the boat and you don't want to ruin all your night vision and just want to look at what you're cutting, you use this knife. It comes with a really hard plastic sheath that has a sharpener built into the sheath.
Right.
Also has a line cutter.
I see that.
So you know your blade is exposed, so you can cut line with it. So SOG, they make a lot of really good stuff, and this is their 6-inch fillet. It's called the Blade Light.
This is really going to work good at my house in Chubb Key.
I don't think that you have to steal that from the Saltwater Sportsman guys, because I stole it from them.
Hey, it's the price of doing business.
Yeah, I reckon. Watch That's this. A nice place.
See how that worked?
You're going to love that. So anyway.
Have them call me.
I will. We got some new Olakais. Now, you know, we've had some Olakais on here before, but these are the new Holomua. Holomua. But what makes these different, besides from the really good rosin footbed, is that they're adjustable. You know, usually when you buy a pair of flip-flops, they're going to be one size. You know, and whatever it is. You really, if you stretch them out, you're stuck with them stretched out. If they shrink up on you, you're stuck with them shrink up on you. But these actually have little Velcro adjustments on the top, so you can make them tighter, which is always good, especially if you're fishing.
Yeah.
You know, when a lot of guys are fishing, you should have some foot covering. And if you're sliding around in a flip-flop, it usually is not a good way to do
you're
it.
You're right on.
So, but if you can tighten them down tight enough, you can probably wear these while you're wiring fish and stuff. Now, the last thing that we got is a lot of stuff from Fish Razor. Now, they've been making a lot of these mud flap kind of like teasers they're called, and daisy
smells
chains.
Smells like a tire.
Exactly. These are fish razors. They come in, you know, all different sizes. What they're made for is to make a silhouette in the water, usually for a teaser. These are all tunas. This is their one that's called the bubbler. It's got holes actually cut in it to make it bubble even more. And, you know, they have a big heavy metal grommet on them so that you can put this in a big daisy chain, or actually put a lure head on here and run it as a teaser. You could probably be crazy and put a hook in it. We ran one of these, a big one like this, in Australia with a big white lure head on it, and you wouldn't believe how many fish just piled on it. They also make them in dredges. You know, like this one comes with, 12, 14-inch tunas on it, mm-hmm. and it makes a huge profile in the water. It looked like a giant bait ball. So fish razor and these dragon flaps from fish razors are really good stuff.
Good job offshore over fellas. Here at the workbench tonight, Jaeger.
A lot of cool stuff. Did good. A lot of cool stuff to choose from.
So. Speaking of profile, my girl over there's got a pretty profile on the Pathfinder. So why don't you tell us what region we're going to?
Well, let me just tell you from my profile. Just kidding. And now on the line, we have Captain Ron Houston all geared up to tell us about that king mackerel bite in the Southwest region. Go for it, Ronnie.
Well, you know, actually, king mackerel can be caught all through the region all year round. Now, from what I'm understanding, November through March can be the best time of year when fish can be caught in bunches. Now, especially if the water temps are in or around the 68 degrees. As water gets warmer, fish tend to scatter and head to the north. But when the water is generally cooler, around 68 degrees, you want to search for schools and open bottom. And I'm literally talking hundreds of fish once you find them. You can also fish warmer water in wrecks and hard bottom. The key areas to fish, anywhere from 18 to 22 miles out when it's cooler. The baits of choice can be trolling planers with spoons until they're located, then using simple bucktails, herring, blue runners, sea witches with mullet strips, especially pink. But generally, out of all year round, summertime can be the best time when fish are scattered to catch your biggest fish of the year. And I've got an example. Got a picture of a kingfish with Chris Workman and company. That's a good-sized kingfish caught in the warmer time of the year. Now, on the offshore report still, a little further to the north, we're talking mangrove snappers. Dump past the Sanibel, concentrate on fishing nearshore wreck 6 to 15 miles out, simply by chumming to get the fish away from the structure and up towards the surface, and then also draw them away from the predators down below. Once you draw these fish away, slow up on the chum and just drop back cut squid, shrimp or pilchards, or you can even try troll rights or bucktails tip. They will also catch the fish. Now, as we get closer to the full moon coming up in the middle of next week, expect a good night bite as long as we have moderate weather. And Rick, I got a question for you. You're not going to be ready for it, but I hope you have me an answer. I've had several captains call me in the last couple weeks in regards to some information and getting involved with the CCS. They help us a lot. Talking about future grouper closures towards the end of the year on the red groupers, meaning that most captains seem to think that we haven't met our quota. What would best be the best way to get involved with that? Who would they contact?
Well, first off, what they need to do, Ronnie, is they need to join CCA, and by that, it helps drive our numbers up so that when we go to talk to the state legislator or the FWC or even go to Washington, we're a much bigger group. That's the single most important thing. But secondly, they can also call. They can call the FWC and tell them what they're experiencing in their region, because certainly biologists can't be everywhere at the same time. So that will actually help by them having input from the different regions throughout the state. Great question, Ronnie. All right, let's go ahead and go inshore.
We know on the inshore side, we know here we are in May, the first week, and we had a good front come in over the weekend, and we still get temperatures dipping down in the mid-50s up to the mid-60s. We want to concentrate right now, hopefully with this weather looking good for the weekend, for the redfish. Stump pass. Now, you want to concentrate on fishing both sides of the intercoastal back towards Gasparilla and fishing the outside bar from the railroad trestle towards Wooden Creek. Now, on the late afternoon falling tide is what you really want to try this week, looking for these fish. As the tides will start to get lower and further on into the week after the weekend, you'll start getting these negative tides late in the afternoon, especially with the approach of the full moon. So the lower tides should be better to find these fish. Baits of choice can be gold spoons, topwater plugs, walk the dog lures, or the Bass Assassin foreign sea shads on 1/8 ounce jig heads in molting, drunk monkey, and golden brim. Also, if you're drifting some of these areas or coming upon a lot of these fish and you can't get them to eat, cut baits, especially if you see the fish and they won't bite. Cut mullet, ladyfish, and pinfish.
fan cast it in the areas, especially if you see the roaming fish that will not bite. Now, like we had a front out over the weekend, people always expect you to be using live bait. Everybody thinks it's about the live bait. Right now, snook can still be caught in numbers along the outside beaches from Marco to Fort Myers Beach and Sanibel to Stump Pass. Now listen, concentrate on the mid-morning high along troughs, blowdowns, rock piles, and passes. Now most guys say the top of the high has been the best out on the beaches, and fish the passes in between or the docks, blowdowns, and sandbars inside the passes. Now, pilchards seem to be working best, but if we get some inclement weather and it blows, if you cannot catch no bait, Captain Joey Benko of Bustin' Loose Charter says small lip plug imitation of pilchards or small finger mullet have been producing fish between 24 and 32 inches. He had that problem over the weekend, and a prime example, a picture of a snook with Gary Fitney on Bustin' Loose simply throwing plugs.
All right, Ronnie, great report. Thanks for the question. Look forward to speaking to you again next week from the CCA Southwest Region. I'm going to go ahead and take a look at the Florida Outdoor Experience hotspots from the Southwest Region. Inshore, tarpon, Big Marco Pass to West Pass. Look for the free jumping and rolling fish using live mullet, ladyfish, pinfish, or cut bait. And then offshore, Spanish mackerel. Marco to Fort Myers Beach, 7 to 12 miles out, fishing the wrecks and large bait schools. Also, look for the diving birds.
Good job, Rick. High five.
No, because I know you're going to do me. You're just going to do me. She's like, got all these things.
Okay, well, stay hooked because when we come back, we're hitting up the Southeast and East regions with two of the coolest captains around coming up on the Chevy Florida Insider Fishing Report.
They make meds for her.
For you.
The Chevy Florida Insider Fishing Report is brought to you by Chevy, find new roads. Alukai, fit by nature, crafted by hand. Best parts, best prices. Bennett Auto Supply. The Florida Keys and Key West. Come as you are. Rapala. Catch the latest at rapala.com. Startron. Cures and prevents ethanol fuel problems. And Yamaha. Reliability starts here.
Chevy Silverado Heavy Duty, strong for all the roads ahead.
Continuing the revolution. Faster, drier, even better built. Designed around Yamaha's latest technology outboards. Still built by the same craftsmen and anglers who launched the Bayboat Revolution. Whether chasing world records, or time on the water with the family, or anything in between, there's a new Pathfinder model for you. Pathfinder, number one for a reason, still.
I'm Captain Rick Murphy, and I'm a life member of CCA. Why am I so involved with CCA, you ask? Because I want our fisheries to be in better shape for my kids and their kids. CCA is working to ensure the future of recreational fisheries and the rights of recreational anglers. The future of fishing starts today with you. How do you want to leave things with your kids? If you're like me, you'll want to make the right choice and go to joinccaflorida.com right now.
For weekly reports from our nine captains and our latest events, make sure to check out our website at thechevyfloridainsiderfishingreport.com. You can also like us on Facebook and even send us your photos, plus follow us on Instagram at Captain Rick Murphy and Official Insider. So, a little fishy told me that our next Southeast captain, Jimbo Thomas, is giving his report from Bimini.
What?
So dedicated, Jimbo. Go ahead and give us the lowdown from Bimini.
Yeah, we're enjoying the good life over here.
That's nice.
So,
Yeah, hey, life is good. We've been doing a little diving, but this darn wind won't quit. But let's talk about some kingfish. I don't know what's going on with the kingfish in the other parts of the state, but right now is when we catch some of the biggest kings of the year here in the southeast region. Now, there's a few ways that we go about to catch kings. We control a 3.5 drone spoon or a pink sea witch in a bonita strip combination behind a number 2 or number 3 planer or on a wire line outfit, and that's the old-fashioned method. Or we can drift and jig with 2 to 3 ounce jigs and ballyhoo, which is how they do it on the party boats, and they do catch a lot of them on those party boats. Or we can fish live herrings, pilchards, goggle eyes, sardines out of the outriggers or under the kites, which is going to be the most productive way most of the time, and that's the way I like to do it. Now, kingfish have some razor-sharp teeth, so you want to fish a piece of number 3 to number 5 wire leader to prevent cutoff. Otherwise, you'll lose a bunch of hooks and tackle. Now, the big kings have been biting throughout the region, and this time of the year, the late afternoon, is when they usually are going to bite the best. Some of the best kingfishing is taking place in the Hillsboro to Boynton area, where my good friend Captain Art Sapp aboard the Native Sun, he's been catching kings in the 30 to 40 pound range on a daily basis. He's been using live goggle eyes and pilchards on the flat lines and under the kites, and he's been fishing in 120 to 160 feet of water. So now I got a picture here, and this week's winner of the Thomas Flyer t-shirt is Catherine Kemp. This is her very first kingfish. And if you want to win your own Thomas Flyer t-shirt, please post your snapper pictures on the Thomas Flyer Fishing Charters Facebook page or Instagram by next Monday. And the photo with the most likes will win their own Thomas Flyer shirt and its snapper next week. Theme species.
All right.
Now, staying offshore, big blackfin tuna have shown up pretty good, which is typical for this time of the year. And throughout the region, blackfins in the 25 to 30 pound range are being caught on live pilchards and herrings on flat lines and also under the kite in 100 to 200 feet of water. Now, the tunas are usually a little leader shy, so we've been fishing with 40 pound fluorocarbon leader and 6-0 circle hooks. Now, the kingfish also like this setup, so be sure to bring plenty of hooks because you might get a lot of cutoffs. Now, these blackfins are low-light feeders, so early in the morning or late in the afternoon, just before sunset, when they're going to bite the best. Or if you have overcast conditions, they'll bite throughout the day typically. And it's also worth spending a little extra time to catch enough bait to live chum these tunas up. That'll really get the action going. Now, moving inshore, tarpon fishing is in full swing in all of the inlets, creeks, and bridges of the Intercoastal Waterway. Although I've heard that in government cut, the fish have been there, but they're not biting very good, probably due to all the dredging and the muddy waters that's going on in the cut there. But live crabs, shrimp, and swimming plastic baits and flies have all been working depending on where you're fishing. Now, when you're using live baits, use circle hooks in the 4.0 to 8.0 range and try to match your hook to the size of the bait. Now, in the inlets and around the bridges, fish have been biting on both tides in the evenings, and with the outgoing tide has definitely been the best. And also around the bridges, you want to fish on the shadow lines. Now, I got another photo here, and this is Atlanta Braves batting coach Greg Walker. He took time off when the Braves were in here playing baseball with the Marlins. He caught this nice tarpon with Captain Joe Gonzalez. And by the way, the Miami Marlins swept the Braves when he was here, so caught a tarpon, but they lost the baseball games. So
that's all right. It's still a good week
totally
for him.
Totally worth it.
Oh, yeah. All right. Well, also in shore, been talking with our good friend, Captain Joe Gonzalez. He tells me that the bonefish have been biting on the bonefish action has been on the slow side in the mornings. I got to get my stuff straight here. But in the afternoon, bite has been good with the bonefish moving on the higher tides. Higher stages of both tides, and that means the middle to the last of the incoming, and then again on the top, the outgoing, through the middle of the outgoing. He's been finding the fish mudding and cruising in the Soldiers Key area south of Caesars Creek. The fish have been moving better on the days that it's windy. So use shrimp and small crabs on a 2-0 offset hook for the best results,
or if you're fly fishing, use shrimp and crab imitation patterns. And he says, don't be scared to strip aggressively, especially in windy conditions. Now, I'm not sure what he's doing out there in the class, but I hope he's talking about stripping that fly line.
I'm sure he is. Great report from the Southeast Captain Harry's region. Jimbo, we're going to go ahead and take a look at the hot spots inshore. Fish your local inlets late in the afternoon with live shrimp and crabs for tarpon up to 100 pounds. And then offshore, fish live herring and pilchards in 120 to 180 feet of water late in the afternoon for the blackfin tunas, kingfish, and the sailfish, which you know about.
I know about them sailfish.
Yes, you do.
Okay, well, Rick, yes? Next week we are going to be at IGFA, and I say we because I'm going to be there too. Hey,
yes.
Uh-huh. At IGFA at Dania Beach on May 15th. It's going to be the CCA Broward event. Come and check that out. It's going to be lots of fun. But now we are going to chat with Captain Mike Holliday about the kingfish in our area. Hey, Mike, how's that south tide treating our kings?
It hasn't been so great. It brought in that cold water, and that's got the kings on the move. You know,
yeah.
In May, in my region, the key to finding kingfish is to find the bait, particularly the Spanish sardine school. The last 2 weeks, the sardines have been on the beach off Jupiter. The kings were there with them. But the last few days, we got that south tide, and with it came the cold water, and that's pushed the sardines south towards Boynton and north towards Stewart and Fort Pierce. And the kings are up in those areas in 65 to 100 feet of water, and even out deeper off of Boynton out to about 150 feet. And wherever those bait schools are, that's where the kings are. On the west wind days, the kings are charging the beach and coming in on the beach to feed. Live blue runners, goggle eyes, bluefish, those are going to take the smoker kings. But if you can't get those baits, a Spanish sardine, that'll outfish a threadfin or a mullet 5-1. Rig them up on a number 4 wire on a stinger rig. Slow troll them around the bait schools. A real key, make frequent turns. Make a lot of turns. It seems like a lot of the bites come in the turns. Average kingfish is going to be 12 to 25 pounds. Fish up to 45 pounds have been caught this week. I got a photo. That's Daniel Markowski. That's a 38-pound kingfish. They caught that on a kite bait. Fishing with a lot of bull fishing charters out of Fort Pierce, and that fish came out of 80 feet of water on the northeast grounds. Now, this time of year is also when the mutton snappers start to gather up in spawning aggregations around the new and full moons. We'll have a new moon next week. As a rule, the larger fish are going to be on the reefs and wrecks in 75 to 120 feet of water, places like the Loran Tower Ledge, the 6 and 8 mile reefs, and all the wrecks in that 75 to 120 feet of water in St. Lucie County will all hold the largest muttons. You'll also do well throughout Palm Beach County this month, fishing below the kingfish schools. You know, when those kings move back in, when the bait comes up, the kings will move back in. When the kings are feeding on the sardines, the chunks of the bait go down to the bottom. When they bite the tail off, the chunks sink down. And the muttons, they'll be underneath them feeding. So you want to use 20 to 30-pound braided line, at least 20 feet of 40 to 50 pound, fluorocarbon leader, and just enough lead to touch bottom. Pilchard, sardines, cigar minnows, and ballyhoo are the top baits. You can fish them live or dead on a 3.0 to 5.0 VMC circle hook. And, the average mutton's gonna be 4 to 8 pounds. Fish over 10 pounds are gonna be pretty common, particularly in that 75 to 120 feet depth. So that ought to get really good for the next couple of weeks.
All right, let's go inshore, Mike.
Well, look, the snook bite's been a little inconsistent still. You know, the fish that were at the inlets a couple of weeks ago have moved back into the rivers. One day you can go to a spot and catch a dozen or more. The next day that same spot is a desert. So, the most consistent bites I'm hearing about are up in the St. Lucie River in Stewart around the Roosevelt Bridge and also in the north and south forks of the St. Lucie River in southern Martin and southern St. Lucie County. There's been a decent snook bite on the docks on the west side of the Indian River, north of the power lines, if you can find the mullet schooled up in that area. So around the bridges, live pilchards, threadfins, pinfish, and mullet are going to be the way to go. Mullet and the bass assassin 4-inch shad in the copper juice color, that's going to be what you want to use in the north and south forks of the St. Lucie River, as well as up in the Ermine River. You can start the day in those areas, fishing the mangroves and the seawalls, and then go to the bridge pylons and marina docks once the sun gets up. Average snook's going to be 5 to 10 pounds. And May is also the single best month of the year to target triple tail in the Indian River, and that bite is basically from the Jensen Beach Causeway to South Bridge in Fort Pierce. And the fish migrate into the rivers from offshore, Then they find a channel marker or a buoy or a manatee's own sign to feed off of. And, you know, if you have side view imaging on your GPS sonar like I have on my Hummingbird, you can just drop your trolling motor, make a circle around the pilings, and see if there's fish on it. But if you don't have it, you got to pull up and use a process of elimination, cast to every channel marker until you find fish. Our triple tail in my region don't hang out on the surface, so it's all blind casting with a live shrimp and a quarter-ounce hookup jig. I like that chartreuse or red color to that jig. You can also fish shrimp on a popping cork. You know, let the bait fall against the base of the pilings, give it about 60 seconds for the fish to bite, reel it back in, cast again, make about a half a dozen casts. If you don't get bit, move to the next marker. Average triple tail is going to be 5 to 10 pounds right now.
All right, Mike, let's talk bass fishing.
Well, Lake Okeechobee is still one of the single best bass lakes in the country. And lately, the south end of the Big O has been the place to find a big sack of greenbacks, right? And the outside grass lines around Ritta Island and Kramer Islands and in Pelican Bay are holding really big numbers of really big fish. It's almost like it's springtime, early springtime. Big fish are being caught all over the lake right now. You can start your day fishing the schoolies, busting the surface in the Clewiston channel there, or fish around the grass, around the water tower using, you know, dye dappers or boss shiners in either a June bug or a watermelon red glitter color. As the day goes on and starts to heat up, you want to go down deep, flip those outside grass lines with an 8-inch worm or a creature bait in the darker colors, June bug, moccasin, anything like that. You can also fish live shiners. Anglers are still catching 30 to 50 bass a day and being off the water before noon. They're all big right now, a lot of 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 pound bass. So Okeechobee is where all the big bass are. The south end of the lake is a place to be. I got a photo, and that's Scott Bullard of Ocala. That's a 9 pound bass he sent to me. He caught that on a Devil's Horse topwater plug, and he was fishing in Lake Russo up in Ocala. So, you know, Okeechobee isn't the only place in Florida right now that's got the big fish on it.
Great report, Mike. We're going to go ahead and take a look at the East Region hotspots brought to you by WaterwayCafe.com. Inshore, snook at the Roosevelt Bridge in Stewart, pilchards during the daytime, shrimp and or swimming plugs after dark, and then offshore, kingfish on the Loran Tower ledge, live thread fins, live sardines, or blue runners on a number 4 stinger wire. You know about that stinger wire?
Not really, but that was a big bass.
It was a big bass.
Hot dang. Okay, well, coming up, we have our Conservation Minute Tip, which you don't want to miss, and our Northwest Region Captain waiting to tell us something we don't know. Stay tuned.
The Chevy Florida Insider Fishing Report is brought to you by Suffix, the world's most hardcore fishing line, Tires Plus, Total Car Care, the IGFA, Conservation Through Education, Get Your Hands Wet, Florida Outdoor Experience, Lumber Rock, Captain Harry's Fishing Supply Company.
Introducing Helmaster, Yamaha's first fully integrated digital boat control system. With Helmaster, you can start your outboards with a swipe of a paw and control them with a single lever. Outboard trim and steering friction adjust automatically as you accelerate and decelerate. Adjust engine speed with the touch of a button. The Helmaster joystick provides the means to navigate and dock precisely with confidence and ease. Take control of your next vessel with Helmaster at your command.
Fish Dock, the total saltwater experience, returns to New Smyrna Beach this Memorial Day weekend. Bring the whole gang to Riverside Park for an incredible family experience. Tournaments, boat shows, seminars, kids clinics, chowder cook-off, and the Fish Dock 5K Fun Run. Visit fishdock.com to register for the new Bill Fish Open, the Offshore Striker Tournament, or the Redfish Trout Challenge for your chance to win thousands in cash, prizes, and much more. Fish Dock, Memorial Day weekend in New Smyrna Beach. Don't miss this one.
Casa Vieja Lodge, Guatemala.
Startron is a multifunctional fuel additive that uses enzyme technology.
StarTron cures and prevents ethanol fuel problems. Engines powered by StarTron treated fuel start easily and run smoothly with fewer emissions and better fuel economy. StarTron restores octane to old substandard fuel. StarTron's enzyme formula enhances combustion for a more complete fuel burn. StarTron, it's not the engine, it's the fuel.
The Chevrolet Cruze, loved in 119 countries around the world. Proof we're not so different after all. It's the new world.
Bonefish and Tarpon Trust and Costa Sunglasses have teamed up for Project Permit, a multi-year permit research program in Florida. Project Permit relies on anglers and guides to tag permit. The catch and recapture data is being used to learn about permit movements in Florida waters and to provide managers with new data that might be applied to management zones. Anyone that has permit fished before can tell you about the art and the skills needed to catch them. It's something that Costa wants to make sure that future anglers have a chance to try, and which is why the data from this tagging program is so important. Our objective is to form policies that protect and conserve permit for our children and grandchildren to enjoy. To learn more and to get started tagging, please visit btt.org.
Rick, that was a nice little blue chair you were sitting in.
Did you like that?
I was
down in the Florida Keys at the La Jolla,
obvious.
Of course.
The La Jolla. Okay, last but not least, we have Captain Hagster in the Northwest region with the latest and greatest. Tell us.
How you doing?
Good, how are you? Why don't you tell us about that magic water temperature that King Max loves so much?
Gotcha.
Okay.
Our kingfish can be found throughout my region. Fish can be found anywhere from right on the beach to 100 plus feet of water. And that water temperature you're looking for is in between 68 and 75. Right now we've got a lot of kingfish. We're at the upper part of it, but we've still got a bunch of them. That's when our kingfish are going to be in full force. We have a spring run and a fall run. Our spring run's usually a little better because the water temperature is usually a little more stable, and we'll keep that water temperature for a while. Our fall run, we usually seem to get those cold fronts pushed through, and it chills the water temperature and pushes those fish right by us. But we still get them in that fall run, but our spring run is definitely better. You can find them on the reefs, artificial wrecks, any kind of live bottom, anything that holds bait is going to hold kingfish. The Reddington Pier is a great place if you don't have a boat to catch them on the pier. You can also catch them off the Skyway Bridge. As far as baits go, redfin, herring, blue runners are the favorite live baits. Also, people use ladyfish and Spanish mackerel for kingfish, to catch those big ones. Or as far as lures go, Magnum or Apollos, stretched 30s and spoons are the favorites for those. You want to slow troll your live baits and fast troll those lures. It's a great way to catch them, or you can anchor up on those rock piles and reefs and actually chunk them just like you would for tuna or any other Spanish mackerel and bring them right to the back of the boat. As far as gear goes, you want to use from anywhere from 20-pound braid, high gear ratio, smooth drag is key, and start off with a light drag. Our fish run anywhere from 12 to 50 pounds. And to keep from those cutoffs, a number 4 to number 7 haywire, depending on the size fish you're catching, I'll help you get those cutoffs. Another trick, keep those drags light on strike, and then bump them up as the fish gets going. That'll get you to hook some more fish because they're going to have that searing run on their first run when they get going. Also offshore, gag grouper. The grouper bite's been good right now in anywhere from 55 to 85 feet of water. Over rock piles and ledges from St. Pete to Bayport, live pinfish and live grass grunts have been the bait of choice. Our fish right now are averaging anywhere to 4 to 12 pounds and a few bigger fish caught in the mix, but plenty of them out there right now. And then moving inshore, Captain Jamie Goodwin of GoFloridaFishing.com's report the snook bite has been good. Right now they're in a transition phase, and they're moving to their summertime haunts. You want to look for fish close to the passes or outside on the outside islands right now. And as far as bait goes, live sardines and pinfish have been the best. And our fish are averaging anywhere right now from 3 to 11 pounds. Also inshore, We've had a lot of rain up north, and St. Joe Bay right now, all those rivers up there are pumping out a lot of fresh water. So the trick right now is with the storm we had last week, the salinity's off, the color's off in the water. So you want to look for the cleanest water you can find up there, and that's where your trout are going to be hung up at. You want to look for places that got good tidal movement, and it'll clean that water up. The fish will be in anywhere from 3 to 6 feet of water over the grass. But you want to use bright baits with that water color being so dark right now, or something with a rattle in it, like a plug, or a Cajun Thunder above your jig will work really well. And I got a photo taken just yesterday of Ed Golden with a nice St. Joe Bay trout.
All right, great report, Hagster, from the Yeti Northwest region. I'm going to steal that from Bree. We're going to go ahead and take a look at the Drummond Community Bank hotspots from the Northwest region. Inshore, redfish on the top of the tide and the beginning of the outgoing tide use live and cut bait. And then offshore, grouper bite in 55 to 85 feet of water over the rock piles and ledges use live pinfish and a pigfish for the bait.
Well, you know what he told me? He told me that he liked Hagster better than Hag, so
oh,
boom.
I thought maybe he might have referred to you as a grass grunt.
What? Okay, so sad but true. We are almost finished talking kingfish, but don't swim away because when we come back, we're announcing next week's theme species right here on the Chevy Florida Insider Fishing Report.
A man. A man and his truck. And tofu. And veggie burgers and raw kale salads. All fine, just not today.
Whatever you do.
Introducing High Country, the premium Silverado.
Do it good.
Silverado, 2014 North American Truck of the Year.
It's 200 streamlined horsepower of Yamaha forward thinking. The all-new F200 inline four-stroke. Whether you're an offshore angler, pontoon cruiser, bay boater, or walleye hunter, the responsive and fuel-efficient F200 combines amazing power and versatility in one incredibly compact and lightweight package. The all-new F200. Legendary Yamaha reliability and the freedom of forward thinking.
It's been said that a bad day of fishing is better than a good day at the office. Down here in the Florida Keys, we have to disagree. Because with over 200 of the world's best charter boat captains and guides, there's no such thing as a bad day of fishing. The Florida Keys and Key West.
Tuning in to the Chevy Florida Insider Fishing Report. Be sure to like us on Facebook and follow us on Instagram and Twitter to keep up with all of our captains, contests, and appearances. You don't ever have to miss a show. You can find full episodes of the Chevy Florida Insider Fishing Report right on your YouTube channel. And don't forget to check out our website for fishing reports in your region. Visit www.chevyfloridainsiderfishingreport.com where you'll find everything you need to know to stay connected. Next week on the Chevy Florida Insider Fishing Report, we are talking snapper. So make sure to tune in to SunSports every Thursday. Plus, you can catch repeats of the Chevy Florida Insider Fishing Report on Fridays and Saturdays. Check snapper. Your local listings for times. You're distracting.
I know, things. Snappers.
Snapper.
That's what we're catching.
Snapper.
Snappers.
So, guys, this weekend, it's Mother's Day.
Ooh,
it is Mother's Day. What are we doing for the mamas?
Well, you know what, Bree? We got this contest. I want to talk about that a little bit more. Remember, we got the contest is sponsored by Bennett Auto Supply. Bennett's Catch a Big One contest will give 4 lucky winners a chance to go fishing on a charter with one of our captains from our show.
4.
Take home a prize pack, and you can only enter through our website, the Chevy Florida Insider Fishing Report. So make sure that you do that, and
maybe you might win a trip with Mike, Jimbo, Jim, Ronnie. And I can't wait to see who those winners are going to be.
Those are going to be some lucky winners.
Somebody's going to be wanting to go with me one day. You know,
I think we should, you and I should put together a trip. We'll leave Brie at the dock.
We can bring Brie, I guess.
We're going to need a big boat for all this.
That's true.
Watch it.
I'm so fat. What are you doing? You going? What are you doing for Mother's Day?
I'm going to Ohio to see my mama.
How's mom?
Mom's good. Yeah. She wishes she was here.
I bet.
I probably need to take all the children out of the house and leave mama alone. That'd probably be the best Mother's Day of all. Just leave her so she could just be by herself for a day.
You know what I think we're doing?
What?
We're going to go to Home Depot or Lowe's and buy a whole bunch of plants and go plant them in the backyard for Mama.
Well, that'll be nice. Wait.
She likes all the flowery stuff.
That'll be nice.
That's so sweet.
As long as you don't make her do it.
No, she's going to sit inside and watch us do all the hard work.
Good.
Oh,
and then we'll make breakfast for her on Sunday. Hey, guys, thanks for watching.
Bye, everyone. Have a nice Mother's Day.
See ya.
See ya.
See ya.
Snapper next week.